بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن سار على نهجه وما استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون ثم أما بعد. So always and forever, brothers and sisters, as we continue with these short Jum'ah type reminders, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from us our efforts, keeps us steadfast in our prayers and in our devotion in worship to Him. We further pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He continues to allow us to preserve and to protect and preserve the legacy and the teachings of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our hearts and in our lives. Allahumma ameen. So actually, today before I begin the Jum'ah reminder, there's something that's on my mind and it's bothering me. And it continues to bother me whenever it happens. As a speaker and as a da'i, but all of us can relate to this. And it really boils down to gossip and backbiting. It's one of those things that would probably never go away. We're always going to be either the subject of people's gossip, or being honest with ourselves, from time to time, we might be guilty of gossiping or backbiting about somebody else. But the point is that even in a pandemic, even in a situation where nobody on planet Earth has control over, it's a clear indication that something is not right. And that you and I, as people and as believers, we have a moral obligation and responsibility to reflect and think, man, if I don't have control over anything that's happening in this day and age, it's a reminder to me that I have to continue to strive to be a good person and do the right thing. But unfortunately, even in a pandemic situation, there are still people out there, and I'm focusing more on our people, the Muslims. There are still pockets of Muslims out there that just even a pandemic won't change them. And that's why I titled this short Jum'ah reminder that whether it be a pandemic, whether it be any other type of tragedy, bad habits die hard. And this is what I want to share with you today. So the first thing is that if we're going to talk about this subject, we need to have a raw and authentic conversation and not try to cover up some of the things that we might be feeling when the subject pops up. But we need to be very straightforward about it. Those of us who might be guilty of backbiting and gossiping about people in whatever way, shape, or form in this day and age, during isolation and during this pandemic, if this doesn't wake you up to stop the backbiting and stop the gossiping, stop taking news from one place to another without even knowing what you're talking about, if this situation can't stop those habits, it's probably nothing will. And like how some of the scholars and even some of our teachers back in Medina University used to say that gossip is one of those types of problems, those habits, that even if the Prophet ﷺ was here, it still wouldn't stop people from doing it. And when we're saying people, we're not talking about every Muslim, we're just talking about pockets of people who just don't seem to care or see anything wrong with talking about other people. And the Prophet ﷺ described that backbiting is that when you remember your brother or you talk about your brother in a situation or on a subject that they dislike. So even if it's the truth, but they don't like it to be talked about with anybody else. So for example, this is a real common example that I hear about all the time. You know, if a woman is pregnant, but she tells the people closest to her, you know, her family and her friends and her siblings or what have you, is like, you know, oh my God, I'm pregnant, but I don't want anybody to know about it yet. I'll make that known a little bit later. But right now, just between us, I can't believe it's happened. She's happy, but she's in confidence. In confidentiality, she's telling people closest to her, don't tell anyone. 5 minutes later, when that news breaks out, you know, somebody picks up the phone, can you believe so-and-so is pregnant? Oh my gosh. even though you're telling the truth. And even though in a conversation like that, you might say, well, people are going to find out anyway. She's eventually going to show. She's going to have the kid. That's none of your business. Do what she said to do. She said to keep it private. And that's the haqq. That's the right that she has over you. And thousands of examples like this. If I tell you something, then I say to you with a disclaimer, don't pass this on, or this is confidential between the two of us, case closed. If that conversation continues now, it's called backbiting. And it's one of the major sins of Islam. And now here's the thing. Why does Islam have such a big problem with people talking about one another? If it's happening so much around the world, in pretty much every culture of every society, of every religion, it's part of what human being is. What's the big deal? Why does Islam have such a big problem with talking about people? Plain and simple. You don't know that, especially when the person you're talking about is not present in the conversation, how he or she would feel about that subject. We don't know that something that might look like it's not a big deal to us, it's a big deal to someone else. If we think it's obvious, people are going to see it. Well, they don't want people to see it or know that it's obvious at that moment. If it doesn't hurt you, it shouldn't hurt the person you're talking about. So the point is that we don't know people's feelings. We don't know what they might think or feel. They might be hurt, they might be upset, they might be angry. And this is, as a result, people have broken relationships, friendships, even marriages have broken because of just simply backbiting and gossip. Now, with that being said, we're talking about just personal relationships, right? Even at a community level, you know, I'm in front of people all the time. But when people disagree with me or have an issue with something I might have said, and even like something that I do or the way that I look or the way that I walk or what have you, whatever the case is, 9 out of 10 times, no one will ever actually come up to you and say, hey, you know, it's very rare that when somebody actually comes up to you and talks to you and say, you know, what you said, it didn't come off right. It doesn't sound right. Or they're confused. And instead of carrying the confusion off and saying, you know, that speaker, man, never listen to him again. Could you hear what he just said? Twisting the speaker's words, taking it out of context, which is what propaganda really is all about. So this is like an internal issue within the Ummah where we pretty much spread propaganda amongst each other all the time. What does Allah tell us to do in a situation like this? If you want to talk about somebody or you bring news about something, Allah says in Surah Al-Hujurat, it's one of the most famous verses we all know about. And you know what's amazing about this surah? This surah is all about etiquettes. It's everything to do with etiquettes and mannerisms. 6 verses later, that's only 6 sentences, Allah gets into it and tells us, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, people of Iman. Meaning, if you have an ounce of Iman in you, an ounce of faith in you, then guess what? That is enough of a reason for you to be somebody who is alladhina amanu. Allah didn't even call you mu'min. He says, if you're just alladhina amanu, if you're somebody that recognizes that that's the wrong thing to do or the right thing to do, you recognize it, even if you don't practice it, so you don't backbite, but somebody's coming to you with gossip and backbiting about somebody else. You see it and you recognize and you're hearing it. Allah says, you're from alladhina amanu. And if that's the case, in ja'akum fasiqun binaba'in fatabayyanu. Allah says that when the person comes to you, and listen to what Allah says, in ja'akum fasiq, that if a fasiq comes to you. Now, to me, that's just unbelievable. Allah is calling the news carrier, the one who's about to gossip. He calls that person, not إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ رَجُلٌ or إِمْرَأَةٌ or مَرْءٌ or شَخْصٌ. Allah doesn't say that if a person, a man or a woman, what have you, come to you with news. Allah calls the person who's just all about just backbiting and gossip, Allah calls the person a fasiq. And the thing is, that's amazing to me. I hope we all know what a fasiq is. It comes from the word fisqun. And fisqun is something that's inherently corrupt. If you leave it for some time, it's going to get moldy, it's going to get dusty, it's going to get rotten. Allah says that this person who is rotten by nature, Allah says fasiq. Those of you who study Arabic, you know fasiq, this is the person who is the doer of the action. It's a quality in them. In Arabic, we call this the fa'il. They're the ones that are actually doing this all the time. It's a quality in them. So Allah says the person. Now, here's the other amazing thing about it. The fact that Allah calls the news carrier a fasiq, the ayah doesn't tell you if they've done it once, if they've done it a few times. So some of the scholars of tafsir explain that it's a possibility that if you do this just once, you carry news about somebody or something without verifying it, without even like having the slightest concern how the other person you're talking about would feel had they heard what you said, Allah says if you do that just once, you're a fasiq, you're inherently corrupt, you're somebody that's got no hope in this world, and Allah's paying attention to that. So Allah says in ja'akum fasiqun bi naba, Allah says that when they come to you with a naba, Naba'un is not the same as khabarun. Khabarun is just news. You have a lot to say and you say it. And it could be good, it could be bad. The point is it's news and it's important. Naba'un is the kind of information that's been announced from a far distance. You know when you shout out to somebody, hey, look, I'm here, come by. Or you're calling out somebody's name, or you're calling and you're speaking to them from a distance. So when whatever has those characteristics of something far away is called naba'un. So what does Allah say? Somebody who's coming to you, we're not just any kind of news. News that should have been far from your ears, but they brought it to you anyway. You were not supposed to listen to that. And he or she was not supposed to carry that to anyone. So the violation has already begun. They violated so many rights of the person that they're going to talk about, or the place or the community that they're going to refer to. They violated so many rights, and Allah hasn't even gotten to the actual instruction of what to do when this happens yet. Just by choice of words and language and structure, already just like, whoa, I don't want to have anything to do with this ayah anymore. So Allah now continues and he says, إن جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا. And here's the point, guys. تبينوا from بينا means clarity. So Allah is telling you that, okay, if you hear this, if you get this kind of news, the first thing, the priority at that moment is, are you sure that's what he said? Are you sure? I was there. I listened to his khutbah. I listened to his lecture. I actually know him. I don't think he would do that. I don't think he's going to be this way. I don't think that that's him or her, whatever the case is. So what does Allah say? And even if you think it sounds so perfect, the news comes to you and it's so accurate, they're telling you every detail on earth, you as the person who's listening to this, because you're alladhina amanu, you're somebody who acknowledges iman and you have it in you, even if it's just an atom's weight, that iman has to talk and be like, listen, I don't know anything about that. Forget it. It's none of my business. Case closed. Walk away. Why? Because Allah says, "An tusbihu." You're going to eventually, if you let that go, you're going to allow yourself to become a qawman bijahala. You're going to become a nation that's just jahil. Remember, the word jahil, jahil literally comes from the word jahlun. Jahlun means somebody that can't control their emotions. So they'll say things and then they'll think after. They'll be angry and just shout, swear, curse, do whatever, think after. Or they just don't care. They don't care about anyone's feelings. They don't care who they hurt. They don't care who they embarrass. They don't care who they're talking about. And they'll just say it. That's what jahil is. Allah says, if one person is going to start gossiping, what that's going to do, it's going to create a culture, because gossip is juicy. It's entertaining. That's why 99% of TV shows and movies out there, what are they all revolving around? Like, you know, somebody was telling me that backbiting and gossip is almost, it's almost become taboo, in the sense that when you talk about it now, you look like a foreigner. Like, you look like you just don't belong on earth anymore. Why? Because culture and society has normalized gossip to the extent where it's perfectly fine. Who cares if somebody is hurt or embarrassed about it? As long as it's not in front of their face, it's just between you and I anyway. So just who cares? That's really what it boiled down to. But to Allah, it's a reflection of our iman. You have real, authentic iman when you can control gossip and backbiting. That's just amazing to me. If not, it's a culture. The kid is going to see his mom and his dad backbiting about everybody else. Guess what the kid's going to do? Even if the parents grow up, you know, and they mature out of that and they say, look, you know, talking about people is not right, blah, 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 blah. Guess what the kid's going to do? The kid might go to school and still backbite, just he won't do it in front of you anymore. So the culture begins. Then that kid, when they have their own family, the same cycle continues. Then their friends. One person in the community does it, 95 people end up doing it as well. We all, it's in our nature that we like juicy gossip and information. But not everything that we like, we act upon and we do. And we know this, and this is a basic principle in our deen. So that's the first thing. I don't really need to go through the entire verse, but just to give you a glimpse of just how irritating and upsetting this subject is, that it's hurting people, it's hurting families, it's hurting communities. And so I'm talking directly to anybody who is listening to this. If you or somebody you know who has a habit of being the news carrier, being the one who loves juicy gossip, so if they don't get it, they spread it. And if they come to you and they constantly bring, you know, inside information, but you don't know if it's for sure, it's just he or she saying this stuff, so it becomes complete hearsay. Say to the person, first and foremost, say, listen, just be quiet. I don't want to hear nothing about that. You don't know that for sure. Say something that puts you in a position that you can stand up to stop this behavior, to stop this attitude. Just do something, because why? People are getting hurt. Even if they don't know that they're being hurt behind the curtain, when they do find out, they're going to be like, oh my God, you've been talking about that all these months and didn't even know it was true. We're best friends. You never even came and asked me. You never even told me that they were talking about me. You knew that this was going on and you never came to me. It's just pain upon pain upon pain upon pain. There is nothing good about talking and gossiping about people. Now, with that being said, pretty much every rule, there are exceptions. Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, in his large collection of his majmu', he actually puts about 5 to 7 categories where there are exceptions to backbiting. You know, when you're standing in front of a judge, when you're seeking counsel and help, that you need to mention the names of so-and-so who have wronged you, who have hurt you, who have taken away your rights. You know, these are separate issues. Maybe one day we'll have a separate khutbah or reminder on that, on the exceptions of backbiting. But that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about the consequences and the dangers and how much people get hurt as a result of this. That's all I want to say in the first part of this short reminder. I'm going to sit down, as I usually do for the jalsa, for the resting period. Even though I don't need the rest, if we would like, we could continue just doing a regular type reminder and count that, and that could be a valid Jum'ah. But this is not the Jum'ah khutbah. I'm not doing a Jum'ah with you. I'm not asking any of you to follow me in prayer, none of those things. So I want to explain that subject in the next part of the khutbah. Lots of confusion out there, but there really shouldn't be any confusion. And I'll show you why, inshallah. But I'm going to just sit here and just take a couple seconds rest. And I'm going to explain to you why I do this Friday reminder this way, why I do it at this time, so on and so forth. Okay, so just bear with me, guys. Let me take a quick break. أقول ما تسمعون واستغفر الله لي ولكم ورسائل المسلمين من كل ذنب فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Man, that few seconds I sat down there just felt amazing. Anyhow, let's get back to this, right? Now, the whole idea of following the imam or following the khatib for Jum'ah or Taraweeh and so on. I'm not going to get into any of the fiqh behind this. I'll just tell you a couple of things. Number one, this is a subject that is still being talked about and debated in the entire Muslim ummah. So if you see, you know, isolated individuals or communities that come up with their opinions, that write articles for themselves, and they share with you their reflection and their thoughts and their opinions, their interpretation on things. Respect it, right? We should always respect, especially when somebody's coming to you and they're not trying to create any sort of fitna. They're not trying to hurt anybody. They're not backbiting about nobody. They're presenting a genuine perspective based on the knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them. Respect that. This is why the scholars, they say, ينبغي على كل رجل أو على كل طالب أن يراعي الخلاف. That every single person or every single student of knowledge should always respect difference of opinion when it's out there. It's a different perspective based on their ijtihad, their efforts. Now, with that being said, put things in the categories where they belong. Jum'ah is a big deal. It's the meeting that the entire ummah has at the same day, at the same time. Like, it's no joke. So if we're all together as an ummah, gathering every Friday at the same day, of the same time, doing the exact same thing, don't you think that this is a decision, a virtual khutbah and experience? Don't you think that this is something that also at least the majority of the ummah should discuss and collectively come to some sort of conclusion? So with that being said, what do you think is the fatwa on the subject out there right now, at this very moment on April, 17th, 2020? What do you think the majority of the major fiqh body councils across North America, perhaps even across the world, are saying? You can go ahead, and it's up to you, but you go ahead, just do the research. Look at all the major fiqh councils and organizations of imams and scholarships across North America, and you'll find almost 99% of them say, we're not ready to do this. And they give their reasons, okay, we're not going to open this door. This is a pretty exceptional situation. We're going to stick with the rukhsa, or the concession Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. We're going to wait. We're not going to do anything. So when you're home, consider Friday as a holiday and just leave it at that. You pray your dhuhr. We're doing these reminders. Now here's the last thing that I'm going to say. I personally am doing these reminders. Lots of shuyukh and scholars and imams and students and so on do these reminders. Why? To be honest with you, it's because I miss Jum'ah just as much as the next person does. I miss it. I miss getting ready, putting on my best clothing every Friday, putting on my perfume and my itr. I miss all of that, grooming myself to like perfection, as if I was getting married every week or something. and just getting out of the house, driving to Jum'ah. I have this habit that I would read Surah Al-Kahf on the drive to Jum'ah, because every Jum'ah I go to is almost like an hour away from my house anyway. And that habit became a part of me. And I miss all of those things. And so for me, being here and doing this kind of Jum'ah, or this sort of Jum'ah style reminder, just makes me feel a bit connected, like I still have something to hold on to about that routine. Secondly, this is also for you all that are listening. We want you guys to also feel and at least know that we haven't forgotten and erased Jum'ah and the routine that we have on this blessed day. Throw it out the window just because we're isolated. It's something to just kind of keep the spirits a little high and to just make us feel good, really and truly. That's what it boils down to. The ahkam, the fiqh, the rulings, the exceptions, leave that to the major fiqh bodies and councils around the world. Let them come to that conclusion. Why? Because this is an ummah-wide issue. So let the ummah decide what the conclusion is going to be. Not one person here, one person there, one person brings out an article, this person posts it on that website and this website, and everybody just goes into a total chaos. Please be careful of that. Wait for the majority of the community to come out with some sort of presentation and some sort of conclusion. And I promise you, when you do that, inshallah ta'ala, you're gonna feel content with regardless what the decision is. If the decision is we're not going to do no virtual Jum'ah, no virtual Taraweeh or whatever, you're going to say Alhamdulillah. Well, you know why? Because it's not just you alone. These are scholars and these are imams and leaders, and they're doing their best. You're going to be able to do that. Why? Because you have supportive cast around you. But when you're the one king, when you're one person like the king of the hill standing there and just shouting at everybody, this is what we should do, this is what I feel is right, it makes sense to me. Quite honestly, it's not your decision, and that's it. Let the rest of the scholars around the world have their input too. And as we sit here at this very moment, that just hasn't happened yet. The majority of bodies out there in terms of committees and groups just simply have said, we're not going to do this. We're not ready to do this yet. Just leave it at that and just say, Alhamdulillah. And let's continue to focus on staying healthy, protecting ourselves and our families, and looking forward, inshallah ta'ala, to being back where we were as a community. But we come back refined, renewed, with a renewed sense of gratitude and appreciation for each other. So the backbiting is gone. The whatever hatred, whatever animosity that was harbored within the heart, that's been erased, it's been flushed out. So maybe that's what we need. Maybe we do need this pandemic just for our own sake, of flushing out and to refining ourselves as human beings and as people, so that we go back to what we were, to go back and stay there. We're good people who want the best for each other. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows us to be there, and if we are there, to keep us there. Allahumma ameen. That's all I want to say, guys. I hope that this was uplifting and at least a good reminder to me and to all of you. So jazakumullahu khairan. Please, please don't forget, as I always say after every one of these reminders on a Friday, is that pray your 4 raka'at salatul dhuhr, okay? I'm going to go do that right now, but I'm going to turn off the camera, inshallah ta'ala. Enjoy the rest of your day. Enjoy the rest of Jum'ah. Remember to do all of the nice things that we do on Jum'ah. Read Surah Al-Kahf. Look out for that 1 hour that you make dua, that the dua is always accepted. And fill your day, fill your Friday with Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azab al-nar. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Thank you all who are commenting, who are saying hello. I give you a big hello right back. And wa alaikum assalam to all of you. Thank you all for your support. Look forward to seeing you again. Take care, guys. Assalamu alaikum.